Good morning, everybody. I'm Paul Lisnick.
And I'm Tamon Bradley. This is WGN-TV Political Report.
The Illinois Legislature will return to the state capitol on Wednesday, 2 months after the COVID-19 pandemic sidelined the spring session.
The announcement from Democratic leaders came after weeks of requests from Republicans and just one day after Governor Pritzker said it was time to get back to work. Safely gathering hundreds of lawmakers and their staff will no doubt be a challenge.
Now, the House will convene at a Springfield Convention Center where they can spread out. The Senate, they'll meet inside the state capitol. Members have been asked to travel separately, will be tested for the virus. Temperature checks and face coverings will be required, and the number of public and press will be extremely limited.
And that's not the only hurdle lawmakers will need to jump. The three-day special session will be limited to just a few specific topics, including the state budget, an economic recovery package, and issues around the November general election.
Democrats do hold a supermajority in both chambers, and while that means they're likely to push through their own plans with ease, Republicans from across the state, they're clamoring to speak out.
We anticipate, you know, a little, and I hate to use the word anarchy, but we anticipate a little bit of that. And so how much we get done will depend on how aggressive members want to be and grandstanding and pounding their chest and beating their fist on the desk relative to everything that's going on. You know, you've got members, particularly Republican members, who have filed lawsuits against the actions of the governor.
You know, the stay-at-home order put forward by Governor Pritzker has made it very, very difficult for not only, you know, working families to get back on their feet again, but also strain on the state and local budgets as well.
Other members of the Republican caucus have accused the governor of choosing arbitrary dates for reopening and using political motivations to drive some decisions. They want public hearings next week and a chance to amend the reopen Illinois plan. The governor maintains he's just following the science.
This virus is still among us. This pandemic is not over. And to pretend otherwise in a misguided attempt to reclaim what we've lost will only make this last longer.
State Senator Sara Feigenholtz is a Democrat whose district covers much of the city's north side and lakefront.
And she joins us this morning via Zoom to talk about what's next. Senator, good to see you. Thanks for joining us. Let me start by asking, the Republicans, of course, seem to feel like they're not getting heard, that nothing they say matters. You've got supermajorities on the Democratic side. But when you go back, will you listen to Republicans and allow them to offer modifications to what's going on?
You know, Paul, I mean, I see a lot of the news and I know what you're talking about. We spend a great deal of time having bipartisan, bicameral talks over the last 4 weeks, mostly on stuff we agree on that we would like to see an economic recovery. None of us are MDs or PhDs or MPHs. I personally believe in the science that the governor is adhering to. As the daughter of a doctor, I think that our governor has put the public and the lives of the people of the state first. We're all anxious to get back to work. None of us enjoy this. This is nothing we have ever experienced. And so I think what you're seeing is a lot of frustration, some clear concerns about the differences in the region. But I think at the end of the day, we're all going to come together and do what's best for the state.
President Harmon is calling for a spirit of bipartisanship. The GOP leader Bill Brady says he will fight the graduated income tax. Is it the plan of Democrats to pass a budget that includes, that accounts for revenue from a graduated income tax being approved by voters this November?
One of the items on the agenda, I believe, is language for the fair tax. But there are, the budget is of grave concern to us because of all the loss in revenue. Of course, you know, rules and regs around economic development. We're all waiting to see what the next recovery package from DC is going to provide to the states because we need it very badly so that we can move forward.
You know, obviously a lot of it, and I know your district well, so lots of smaller restaurants, smaller shops, they may not survive this pandemic economically. I'm just sort of curious, if it brings larger chains, larger restaurant chains, for example, and stores into the district, is that a bad thing?
You know, Paul, I don't, I would like, we live in a community of independent businesses, and these are the heart and soul, small business is the heart and soul of our communities. And right now, what we are trying to do is to provide every lever we can to these small businesses to bring them back and keep them afloat. We have limited resources. Many of us were counting on the PPP loans. You know that some of these restrictions that the feds have put on our small businesses, they need to fine tune the June 30th date and push it out. They need to give bars and restaurants who are still closed more flexibility around that. They need to give them more flexibility around the 75%, 25% split. But there's, we can't really be responsible for what the feds do, but we have to watch them because we need their help. But what we can do are small incremental things. We can discuss broadening the diversion of the sales tax for small businesses. We could talk about allowing things that have very broad support are the ability to sell mixed drinks or drinks for delivery. Right now, just some little things that will, little levers we can pull that will help these small businesses stay afloat.
Senator, you have a long history of working in adoption and child welfare. I wanted to ask you about the temporary ban on foster care children having supervised visits with their parents and siblings. The Cook County Public Defender is suing. What's the reason for this ban?
You know, the battle, it's a difficult discussion, and it's fascinating. I think it's very important that we reunify families and we keep children connected to their biological families. And now we are facing a pandemic that requires a lot of PPE, a lot of social distancing. It puts some of our frontline workers who are actually doing these visits with these children at risk. And so right now the court has got to opine on this and let us know and give us direction on how to do it.
You proposed helping business owners negotiate coverage with business interruption carriers, insurance carriers. Just sort of curious how you doing that, because, insurance contracts say what they say. Insurance companies are often in the business of finding a way out of having to pay. How does the legislature make its way into those kinds of relationships when somebody's already signed off on the insurance agreement?
Well, this is something that we're discussing that was on a list that the retailers, especially the bars and restaurants, are concerned about. Some of them do have policies, Paul, that fall silent on a virus. And I believe that those are the ones that are in federal court suing. It's something that's likely to be a class action. There's about 8 states that are moving legislation that they slightly vary, but it creates sort of a pool of money for economic recovery for these businesses whose insurance companies did not pay for business interruption. But even better, I believe that they are talking about this on the federal level. And, we're moving legislation forward, but you should also know that we're looking to Washington to see if they can help remedy this problem.
Chicago has a lot of requests. Do you expect the legislature will pass the Chicago casino fix during the special session?
I sure do. I mean, I think that those of us who have waited for an infrastructure bill for our schools to build parks, things that really are in a state of repair, are depending on the revenue from that casino to pay off the bonds that will build our schools. So, the city of Chicago really needs this to and I know the mayor and her staff have been working with our leadership in both chambers and the governor's office, and we're really hoping we can do it in this, because we need to get moving on this.
Just about 30 seconds left. There was a letter sent out by yourself, your other Democratic colleagues, requesting a lot of things, such as the curbside delivery of alcoholic beverages, which Damon and I are hoping gets passed. But that being said, I'm just sort of curious, no Republicans signed on to that. Is that deliberate? Are they not supportive?
No, that's not true. That's not true. There is a broad support for this, Paul.
Okay.
Republicans and Democrats in both chambers are supportive of this. I have not heard one colleague of mine in any of these work groups, no matter what side of the aisle they're on, not think that this was a really, really sensible thing to do, because the truth is that we don't really know what the future holds as far as social distancing. And we need to help these bars and restaurants reinvent themselves so that they can continue to flourish as independent businesses.
All right. State Senator, we're going to have to leave it there. State Senator Sara Feigenholtz, thank you so much for joining us. We're going to take our first break. Up next on WGN-TV Political Report.
We're asking for parents to do something they are ill-prepared to do.
Chicago students and the digital divide. We're talking to the teachers union about education in the pandemic.
And later, the plan to put off some of the financial pain for Cook County property owners. We're talking to County Treasurer Maria Pappas.